I guess I can kind of begin. I'm going to talk a little about Puppet testing, especially your modules. First, we're going to start off with why you should test. I know a lot of us kind of skip the effort and go straight to production. And I also give a quick introduction on how you can test. First off, who am I? Well, I'm Jan. For the English people, if you can't pronounce the J, please replace it with an I, like Ion, instead of Jan. Don't do that, please. You can mail me, I have a blog. I also have GitHub, which is pretty much everybody's homepage, I suppose. We're on Twitter, EFC. I'm doing work as a sysadmin. Well, sysadmin, the line is getting rather thin between developer and sysadmin, since we're all developing Puppet. I work for Inuit, but I work at Unified Post. When I started writing this presentation, I was kind of in trouble, because testing has really a lot of possibilities. There's a lot of stuff you can test. And I was struggling with how to get it all into one nice presentation. So I decided to just make it a story, pretty much my story. How did I end up writing tests? And every story starts with the beginning. And in the beginning, you just write simple modules. Don't do too much, no complexity, really the basics. And testing, I mean, who needs testing, really? And we were also kind of hacking on production. There was no test environment, just SSH to the Puppet master, try something, try a Puppet test, oh, it fails, try again, and so on, and so on. Well, that doesn't kind of keep going. You learn Puppet, you learn new tricks, and you start growing. You start evolving. You start adding complexity. You have to deal with parameters, you have to deal with different distros. And hacking on production in that case is kind of getting a little tacky. You should really stay away from that. And then I learned about Vagrant. Vagrant is awesome. Is there anybody who isn't using Vagrant? Oh, poor people. Poor people. I'm just going to touch the surface of a Vagrant here. What can you do with Vagrant? Well, you basically test your machines locally. You bring up a virtual machine, you test something, and you bring it down again. What are the advantages? Well, you have an exact environment. You can even, if you can convince your developers, provide them with a Vagrant box and tell them, well, this is going to be exactly the same as on production. If you convince them, they will love it. What can you also test? You can even test host interactions. You're not limited to one Vagrant box. You can bring up two, three Vagrant boxes and see how they cooperate. You can have a MySQL server, a web server, and see how stuff works. The core of Vagrant is a Vagrant file. I've pasted a small example. What you basically do is you define the name of your Vagrant box. You can also skip that define if you only have one, but I tend to use multiple boxes in one Vagrant file. You define the box you can want to use. In my case, I have a box called Puppet 3, but you can also have CentOS, Debian. There's plenty available on the internet. Besides that, you just set the host name, a network if you want boxes to interrupt, and the provisioning. As you will notice, I'm not using the Puppet provisioner. I'm not a big fan of that. I like to have control on my Puppet runs, so I use a custom script to run Puppet. If anybody's interested in that, I can surely paste that somewhere. I've added a couple of links, the Getting Started, just links to the Vagrant Up website, and my improved Vagrant file. Well, since I've learned some Ruby, I kind of messed with the Vagrant file too. If you're interested, click through and you can see for yourself. I'll try to put the presentation online as soon as I find working internet somewhere. But this really is what I call poor man's testing. It's not on production, but we're still not actually testing what our module does. Well, we are, but we're testing the general effect of what the Puppet run does on our machine. We're not testing the code itself. And we're still losing time. Vagrant up, Vagrant down. It takes way too much time. As a bonus, if you have an SSD, Vagrant will go a lot faster. If you don't have one, get one. Another thing you lose a lot of time with is the complete Puppet stack. I'm not saying it's slow, I'm just saying it's slower than not using the complete Puppet stack. This is a nice cartoon one of my colleagues made. It's based on the original code compiling, but Vagrant up. So now we're kind of testing. Well, we're not doing it on production anymore, but there's still a lot of room for improvement. And around this time, I was kind of tired of doing a Vagrant up and noticing, oh, I still have a syntax error. Try again, try again, try again, over and over again. So we should try to catch these syntax errors before we do the Puppet run. And we can do that easily with Puppet parse and validate. It's that simple, you have no reason not to do it. Besides the syntax, I also like testing style. I know some of my colleagues don't care about style, but I do care about style, because you can catch some common little mistakes that the syntax test will pass, but they can bite you in the ass later on. Some have been mentioned in the bad Puppet talk previous. Quoted booleans are especially mind-breaking at times. I'm not sure if the factor stuff has been fixed, but factor used to still add booleans as strings. I'm not sure if that has been resolved. I'm looking at somebody of Puppet Labs, but they all keep quiet. There you go. Also, if you start messing with variables that aren't really Puppet variables in your commands, you can also run into a wall. And besides that, pretty code debugs easier. Especially if you have to look at somebody else's code, you'll be happy that he kind of follows the guidelines. And for that, we have Puppet lint. Big ups for that. Well, now the problem is, I'm kind of big on testing, syntax testing and Puppet lint testing, but my colleagues still aren't. So maybe we should automate it a little bit to make sure that this kind of stuff doesn't get into production, because before it sure as hell did. You can do it by using Git hooks, if you use Git, of course. And I would mainly use Git for the small stuff, using hard tabs, training white spaces. Doing a basic syntax check also fits in here. Or you can throw the big boys against it and start using a CI tool like Jenkins or Travis. So, hello Jenkins. Time to implement some Puppet testing in Jenkins. You can either test your complete tree, or a single module. I think it will all depend on your specific use case. You can either write custom bash scripts in Jenkins, or you can use Rake, Rake being a Ruby gem. One particular useful plugin for Jenkins is the warnings plugin. I'll show you some screenshots right about now. They give you a nice graph, and you can parse out the different errors or warnings that Puppet Lint spits out. You can do the same for syntax checks, but then you still need to add some custom code in Jenkins. I also linked the Jenkins Puppet scripts. It's a small collection of tools we use, some bash scripts I mocked up for our Jenkins setup. So this is pretty much how our Jenkins setup looks like. We have several pipelines going through different stages of code testing. It's rather small, but well, you get the big picture. So when you do the syntax checks with some hacking on Jenkins, you can get a nice overview of the different kind of errors and where they are. Same for style. As you can see, the red line on top is really small, which means that all the hard errors that Puppet Lint warns us about, well, I got rid of them. Sometimes somebody forgets and still pushes hard tabs or trailing spaces, but we have improved a lot. And you can also get a nice overview on the different kind of errors you get. Maybe I can... No, zooming in isn't working properly. Well, check it online when it's there. So far, so good. We've improved. We're doing some testing. But, well, we're still not testing the actual functionality of our module. And we've learned a lot since we started with Puppet, so we kind of keep adding complexity to it. Especially at first with functions and facts. The most common objection to that is, well, I don't know Ruby. Just start off with copy-pasting stuff, even from Puppet Lab's own sources. You can easily copy-paste, modify. We all know how scripting works, and it's pretty much scripting. And while you're copy-pasting, you will also learn Ruby a little. And you can work further on that. And I was getting really tired when I was writing a function. Keep doing vagrant up, vagrant down, vagrant up, vagrant down, provision, 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 and so on, and so on. So the need for more specific RSpec tests, it got urgent. And I mean, how hard can it be? Well, not that hard. You just need the right toolkit to do some testing. It basically exists out of Ruby. That's pretty obvious. Ruby gems, also pretty obvious. And then we're gonna add Bundler to the game. What will Bundler do? Well, Bundler will manage our dependencies between our gems we want to use. I'll get to that later on. We need a gem file, which contains all the gems we need, and a rake file. Those are the basic components. And of course, we also need tests. This is a basic example of a gem file. You can pretty much copy-paste this in every module you have, and it will get you going. Small remark, as you can notice, the Puppet version here is kind of determined from the environment. We'll get to that later when we're going to test multiple Puppet versions. You can easily just add gem Puppet and be done with it. Once we have that gem file, you can start using Bundler, just install it, and then you run bundle install, and I use -- pulp to .vendor, and he will install all the required gems in that subfolder. That's only going to take a minute, well, depending on how long it takes to query the RubyGems website, if it's up. And once that's done, you can just start using it. And you can run any command your gems provide by using bundle exec puppetlint, for example. I don't know if you noticed, but I included the puppetlint gem in my gem file, so that will be available. Next is the rake file. And you have a couple of options. I tend to use the first option. I just copy-paste an existing rake file I have. Or you can use RSpec Puppet. It's a nice tool that comes with a command RSpec Puppet init, and that will set up a basic testing structure for your module. Once RSpec Puppet has generated that rake file, I'm going to check if I can. I've made a small adjustment here. Normally this is just spec. I'll come to that later. So we have this basic rake file that was generated for us, and we can immediately start using rake. The bundle exec rake minus capital T will give us a list of the different tasks that are available. Now, I want to add some more complexity, so I added the Puppet Labs spec helper gem too. And by just adding that one line of require, I immediately gain several other tests. Note that lint has been added too, and that has been done by the Puppet Labs spec helper. So now that we have our basic structure, well, we need something to test on, obviously. And no better example than start with testing a function. I've mocked up a simple one. This will just basically generate the MySQL password. I just blindly copy-paste it. It's from somewhere. And as you can see, it's pretty simple. And to go with that, we write our spec file. So what do we do here? Well, the first step is to check if that function exists. If I made a mistake somewhere and Puppet can't find the function, well, no need to test any further. So the first part will see if the function is available in the Puppet stack. The second test is, well, we can't just throw any argument or parameter to that function. It's pretty obvious it will only work on strings. So maybe we should test for that too. So we write a test to see if I add a hash, it should fail. And finally, we want to test if the function actually provides us with a MySQL hash. So we test that too. Some of the text is cut off, but I'm not sure if that's a problem. So now that we have written that test, we can run it. And we just do that by running bundle exec rake rspec. And he tells us that everything is finished, no failures, which is awesome. The only downside is I have no clue what tests have been run. I see 3 thoughts, that's it. So we're going to tweak that a little bit. I like to see some more information. So we just add the rspec opts, and we let him read a file. In that file, we just add some command line arguments, which he should include by default. And instantly, when we run the test, oh, that's a lot better. We actually see what has been tested. Kudos for that. Later on, we also might want to start testing effect. I'm not sure if I should go through this again. It's pretty much the same, we have a fact, we write some tests, and see if the output is what we expect it to be. I've started a GitHub repository with the link there, and added all these little examples, and I will try to keep adding examples. So keep an eye on that, or if you have a good idea, pull requests are welcome. So besides functions, facts, what else can we test? Well, it's pretty obvious. We might want to test classes, even nodes. I'm not going to go into that because I think that tomorrow there's a talk on RStack Puppet. If you're interested, I suggest you follow that talk. We can also test Jira. And up till last week, I was missing obvious tests. But I think Dominic is somewhat working on that, and his gem should be available soonish. There you go. And now I'm going to quickly go over some common examples. I'm not going to go into detail because, well, you learn stuff a lot faster if you do it yourself, and RStack Puppet has pretty proper documentation on his website. Nevertheless, what is the kind of thing that we will be testing often? Well, distro support and different parameters. So let's start off with a distro support example. How do we do it? Well, we kind of fake the facts to tell us that the operating system is CentOS and your OS family is Red Hat. And then we write a test. In our case, it should include a custom class. We expect that it will. And it should also include the file foo with the path in somewhere in etc sysconfig. Obviously, you can just repeat the complete describe block on CentOS, make it describe on Debian, change the fact and check if everything is Debian-wise configured. Same thing for parameters. You can define a certain context, define the setting of your parameter, and then check if it has the expected result. In our case, it shouldn't contain the file foo. These examples are also available on that particular GitHub page I posted earlier. So, what is our conclusion up till now? It's really not that hard. We don't have any reasons to say, oh, I can't do that. No, you can easily copy-paste your way into testing without extra effort. It's a lot faster than doing a Vagrant or Puppet Apply. Especially if you're going to test a function, you don't want to test the complete manifest. You just want to test that one function if it gives you the result you expect. So we're testing on a limited scope. If you run into a problem, you can narrow down to the exact test that fails. If you do a Vagrant up, you know, okay, something is broken. You can start looking through your Puppet output, try to determine the cause, but using tests will narrow it down pretty much till the very line or function you're trying to use. And we use a lot less resources. There's no need for Vagrant. All I need is my machine and Ruby gems, and we're good to go. So besides the obvious advantage for me as a developer, there are also some other quirks that kind of come for free. You can start developing new features without worrying about breaking whatever is in production now. You can just use your tests, modify whatever you need to modify, and see if your tests still run. If the test fails, well, try to resolve it before putting it in production. It will also help you, others help you. By writing these tests, you automatically document what you expect from your module. So if I, as a contributor, start adding new code, well, I can safely say, if your tests still run, I haven't broken your module. If the tests do fail, well, maybe I should work on it a little harder. And it also gives you, as upstream, a good reason to decline pull requests. You broke the test. Discussion closed. On the other hand, I forgot to include this, when you file a bug report and the module has tests, you can easily write a simple test that demonstrates the bug you're trying to explain. That's very easy. It's even easier for the developer. He just needs to include that test and he can start debugging it on his own system. Now that we have these rake tests, or spec tests, however you want to call them, we can also start automating that. What's the advantage here? Well, we can automatically see if the module still does what is expected, and if you combine Travis with GitHub, he will automatically test all the pull requests you get. So you don't even have to pull in that code, see if your tests are still running. No, when you use Travis, that is done automatically. So how do we use Travis? Well, it's fairly simple. How about that? What are the advantages of using Travis? Well, you can easily test multiple Ruby versions. Maybe if you write custom functions, you want to test Ruby 1.8 and 1.9, but you don't feel like setting up all those boxes, just use Travis. You can also test multiple Puppet versions. You want to test against Puppet 2.7, and you want to test against Puppet 3. That's also easily doable. And how is it that it is so easy to do? Well, because of the Puppet Lab spec helper, they kind of introduced a feature that you can use in when you write tests. You always need certain static files. You need, for example, your module to be available. And that's why you use the fixtures directory in which you put all that information. When you have a single module, that's easy. As you will notice, when you run the rspec init script, it will automatically set up that fixtures directory with some siblings to your own modules. When you use the Puppet Labs spec helper, you can use the .fixtures.yml file, which does things a little differently. And last but not least, you need a .travis file to indicate to Travis what needs to be run when he tries to test your module. And as a bonus feature, it integrates nicely into GitHub. This is pretty much how it looks. In this example, I am testing against two Ruby versions and two Puppet versions. And everything is green, all is good. So, what do we really need? Well, we need maybe an external module. When you normally want to include external modules in your fixtures directory, you can add it as a submodule, but really that's bothersome. When you use the .fixtures file, you can just add the repositories. I've used the stdlib here, for example, and it will automatically make sure that when you run your tests, that module is available in that fixtures directory. And then, of course, we add symlinks to our own source file. The travis.yml file tells Travis what to test. In this case, we're going to test on Ruby. We'll be using RVM version 1.8.7, 1.9.3. The script to run is rake spec. We define different environments, environment variables. He will do a run one time with Puppet version 2.7, once with 3.0. These two environment variables, Puppet version, are the ones that we saw earlier in the gem file. In the gem file, we included based on the environment variable which Puppet version to use. Well, this references to this file, to these two options. And optionally, you can specify which branches that need to be tested in Travis. As a side note, the .travis file must exist on the master branch. Even if you don't want to test your master branch, you still need to put that file there. Once the file is there, you will not test your master branch, but it should be available. How can you start using Travis? Fairly easily. You sign up, you sign in with your GitHub page, click the click to your profile, and he will automatically give you a list of all your GitHub repositories that you have available. There's an on-off button, you click it, and it is done. So that's really no extra effort whatsoever. So now nobody has a reason not to test properly. So in the end, what are the advantages of testing? Well, it's not that hard, it's a lot faster, we test in a limited scope, and it's easier for debugging. The only downside is, during my last year, I noticed that there is not that much information on testing. In the Puppet Labs website, they briefly touch it, referencing RSpec Puppet and the extra gem, but there are no real examples available. That is pretty much why it took me so long to figure it all out, and I hope that we can change it in the near future. Are there any questions on that? I realize it was a quick overview, but most of the stuff, well, you learn better by doing it yourself. Nevertheless, are there any questions? Yes. No, we've started setting up something with Vagrant and Jenkins, but apparently the Vagrant plugin for Jenkins doesn't work very well when he has to run a slave. So that has been postponed until further notice. Any other questions? Perfect. Thank you for the attention.